Good morning. Welcome, everybody, here to the Heath Church of Christ. My name is Dave Mason. I serve here on the ministry staff. And so before we get into our worship time here, I have a few things to just make you aware of. First of all, if you are a guest here today, we are so glad you are here. And we love knowing that we have guests. And one way that we can know that you're here is if you would go to the connection point, you'll see it out there at the Welcome Center there. If you're new to us here, we'd like for you just to check in out there. We have a gift bag for you, which includes a card from Coffee Shack. So it's a gift card from Coffee Shack, so it's worth stopping by the connection point. Hopefully that'll resonate with you there. If you are new here to HCC, you can also connect with us by scanning the little QR code on the back of your chairs, and you can connect with us there. Let us know that you're here. Also, in addition, if you're new to us here at HCC, today, right after this service, we are having an event that we have on a regular occasion called Pizza with a Pastoral Team. And it's a lunch right after our services here. Now, you don't have to sign up for this. All you got to do is just show up for this. And the idea behind this free pizza gathering is for us to just to get to know you more, help you find out additional ways to get plugged in here at HCC. And the Pizza with the Pastoral Team will take place in the Fireside Room, which is on the far west side of the building. It'll be right after this service is over. We'd love to see you participate in that. Over the past several weeks, we have been talking about this year's International Conference on Missions. It's taking place at the Columbus Convention Center, first part of November, November 3rd through the 6th. And I want to just encourage you to consider attending this year. ICOM is an incredible experience to see how the gospel is on the move throughout the whole world. It's also an opportunity to see how God is working and moving here locally. And so here's the good news on this. As a church, we are registered as a church, and that means that you and your family can attend all of ICOM at no cost. And there you'll find an exhibit hall with over 325 organizations there to meet those individuals. Also, you can attend five different workshops on various mission topics. And then there are the main sessions with thousands of attendees. I would encourage you to be a part of that. And one time we're going to try to go as a larger group would be November 3rd, Thursday, November 3rd. That's the opening night. And you might want to plan on coming with attending with your family or your journey group. You can carpool with friends. And again, we're aiming to have a large attendance gathering from HCC for the opening night, Thursday, November 3rd. And the two most convenient ways you can pre-register for this event, again, you don't have to pay, but you do need to register. You can use the QR code in the Sunday program, or there's the link on the church app. We hope to see you there as part of that. So as we can prepare to get into our worship time this morning, I would encourage you to stand if you would, and we'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll turn things over to our worship team here. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for this day of life that you've given to us. Lord, I just thank you for the privilege to worship together, to gather together as a body of believers. Father, I thank you for those that are gathering all over the world to remember Christ and to learn from his word and to give honor to you. And Lord, we pray that our worship here today would be pleasing in your sight. We give you the honor and glory. We acknowledge you as Lord over all creation. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Father, pray. Praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings.
To reveal kingdom come and to reconcile the lost, to redeem.
Sing praise the Father, praise the Son.
Praise the Father, praise the Son.
Christ
was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint.
By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Sing for
heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will. For all my days. Yes, I will.
And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names.
Nothing can stand against.
And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names.
Nothing can stand against.
And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. And I choose to praise, to glorify,
stand against.
Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will. I will for all my days. Yes, I will. What a privilege it is to come together and to worship together as a body of believers. And I don't know what kind of week or month or year that you've had, but I'm glad that you're here praising in this moment this morning. Because we have the Father, we have the Son, and we have the Holy Spirit gathered in this place with us as we worship together. I do know that sometimes the difficult path that we're on are things because of circumstances that we've created on our own. Times when we've decided to take Christ off the throne and put ourselves in that place. And it creates chaos and it creates turmoil in our lives. So we begin to separate ourselves from God's design. I'm thankful that we have an opportunity as we get together to reflect and to look back and to think through the past week and to seek the cross and to find grace and mercy and forgiveness there. As we continue to sing this morning, may this be our prayer of consideration, our prayer of confession. We don't always do things right, and we fall short, and we need the blood of Christ to cover us. Let's continue to lift him up as we sing these words, Lord, I need you.
Lord, I come. I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh God, how I need you. Your sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am. Holiness is Christ. Christ in me. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness, it's Christ in me.
You to be seated at this time, and as we gather around the Lord's table this morning, let's use this as a reminder of all that he endured on the cross for us, that where grace is found, Christ is, and where Christ is, we find mercy and grace. Let's take the emblems and give him thanks this morning. Heavenly Father, all honor and glory and power and praise are given to you, because you and you alone are worthy. We celebrate you this morning for all that you have done, that you were mindful of us, that you sent Christ to die, to go to the grave, and to resurrect on our behalf. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to praise you no matter the circumstance. We thank you that you are near us in every moment. This morning we claim our dependency on you, that apart from you, our lives are nothing. But with you, they have meaning and purpose and significance. We find hope and satisfaction in the name of Christ. Lord, we ask your blessing as we continue to worship this morning in the study of your word, as we read it and hear it, as we put it into practice. Lord, may you continue to motivate us for your kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning, church family. My name is Mark Smith, and I would like to talk to you about Faith Promise and the missions and missionaries that we support around the world. The Missions Committee works to share with you each month a short video from one of our 15 missions that are advancing the gospel of Christ throughout the world. Together, we are able to uplift our missionaries with encouragement, prayer, and financial support. This year's Faith Promise theme is Believe and Be Astounded, which is based on a Bible verse from Habakkuk 1:5, and it says, "Look at the nations and see, be astonished, be astounded, for a work is being done in your days that you would not believe if you were told." As for what the Lord is doing today, we have two excellent speakers encourage us. Frank Shatner, and he'll be doing that on October 30th, and Leonard Thompson on November 6th. You may be asking, What is Faith Promise? Well, these are the two Sundays, October 30th and November 6th, that we'll be making pledge cards available to you, and we ask that you will write the amount you plan on giving for the coming year. No names will be on these cards. This is between you and the Lord. This enables the mission committee to make appropriate plans for next year. Our goal for 2023 is $125,000. That's about $5,000 more than last year. These are the funds that will be used to support our missionaries next year. So this is what I ask of you. For the next few weeks leading up to Faith Promise, would you pray and consider what the Lord would have you give? I believe this is one of those things that the Lord wants us all to be part of. While we're on the topic of missions, I want to let you know that ICOM, which is the International Conference on Missions, is meeting at the Columbus Convention Center November 3rd through the 5th. The leaders of our church believe that this is a very worthwhile event and has made it possible for us to attend at no cost. More information will be shared later. And last, I'd like to put a plug in for the Missions Committee. I have truly enjoyed working with this team for the last 2.5 years. We have 15 wonderful people on the Missions Committee that meet at the church on a monthly basis for about 2 hours. We will be needing 5 new church members to rotate on in January with a 3-year commitment to replace the 5 that are coming off. Would you consider being part of this team? If so, see me or any of the mission committee members or the church leaders, and we'd love to discuss that with you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Mark, for the words regarding the Faith Promise. Mark's done an excellent job as our chairman this last year of our mission team. I'd like to just clarify that some people ask the question, why are you inviting me to a missionary conference? Well, this is the International Conference on Missions. It's not just for missionaries. Missions, friends, is a family business. That's what we're all about. There are 3,000 hotel rooms that are already reserved in Columbus. There are 200 churches that are already registered. This is a place we go to, and it helps us to keep the family business alive. So we invite you to be part of that. And the reason why Faith Promise is a little earlier this year is because we typically place our Faith Promise before and after ICOM, wherever it is, because we have a wider selection of speakers. We are picking the best of the crop. Frank Shatner is a guy that competed against Bruce Jenner in the decathlete back in the day, and God called him into other plans after that. He's going to be here next weekend. It's just going to be phenomenal. And we have a men's breakfast Saturday morning, and then Sunday he'll be speaking with us. And then, as you heard, the other. But I want to encourage you to be part. In terms of Faith Promise, you may be interested to know, our giving this year, our goal is $120,000. We're at $97,000. If you do the math, we're at 81% of our goal. If you do the digital map on the calendar day of this year, we are at 81% of the year. So let's finish strong. We're on track, and let's be able to give our partners what they need to get the job done, okay? How many have ever heard the statement, the shortest distance between point A and point B is a straight line? You heard that before? What do you do, however, when there's a mountain between point A and B, or if there's a ravine or a roadblock? Somebody said, what do you do if the distance between point A and point B is boring? We had a vacation plan 2 weeks ago between point A here and Southwest Missouri. 12 hours of driving. My wife had a medical issue she needed to attend to, so she scheduled a doctor visit in Indianapolis with a trusted physician that she's known for some time. We left Friday morning that day with 1 hour of extra time just to eliminate any surprises. We get into Indiana, and of all things, there's a terrible semi-truck accident that has the road blocked for 6 hours, and we found out after we passed the last exit before you could get off. Well, my wife, through tears, called the doctor and apologized and had to cancel the appointment. By God's grace, on our way through Indianapolis, we found a physician who was, or a chiropractor who was able to help alleviate some of the discomfort. And on our way back through Indianapolis a week later, we had a doctor's visit that we made. We found out that the distance between point A and point B is often much more complicated than what we expected. Have you ever experienced that? Somebody said this, although the distance between point A, the shortest distance is a straight line, why are flight routes a curved arc? Another said, there are no straight lines. Let me just ask this question, maybe this will help simplify it. How many of you here this morning got from where you were in your childhood to where you're at today on a straight line? We're all in the same boat, aren't we? There's a lot that can happen between point A and point B. Well, this is the Apostle Paul's dilemma as we come this morning to the end of Acts chapter 27 and 28. We're going to finish the Hope series today, but I want to encourage you to go to Acts chapter 27 because there we really get a picture of how complicated life can get between point A and B. Paul made it very clear way back in Ephesus in Acts 19, which was a few chapters back, he wanted to go to Rome. In 19:21, he says, after I've been to Jerusalem, I must visit Rome. Jesus affirms that desire in Paul's life. Four chapters later, he says in Acts 23:11 to Paul, as you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must testify about me in Rome. So we know this is God's plan. But how is he going to get there? The distance from where Paul is at to Rome is 2,000 miles. You think there's a straight line between where he's at? We're going to find out here this morning. This is going to be fun. So, why do we even have books in the Bible like the book of Acts? I think the book of Acts and other books just help remind us of what life is truly like. When reading a book of the Bible, it's very helpful to ask the question, what would we be missing if we didn't have this book? And if we didn't have the book of Acts, one thing for sure we would be missing, we would never understand how the gospel which gave birth in Jerusalem would end up over 2,000 miles away in Rome, but we would also not understand just how complicated the distance can become between point A and point B. I do want to encourage you this morning that even though that distance becomes complicated, even though through the journey life gets very difficult, if God is in it, you're going to get there. And I want to encourage you with that truth this morning. Are you in Acts chapter 27? Are we ready to get into this chapter? It's a beautiful chapter. I think we could have very easily skipped from chapter 26 and dropped into chapter 29, and Paul could have been summarized by Dr. Luke, who wrote this journal out and saying, well, eventually Paul got to Rome. But we would miss the application of how Paul got to Rome and how that applies to our lives as well. So going into Acts chapter 27, let's just catch up with the Apostle Paul here. After his multiple trials before world-class leaders, sharing and defending his faith, he's put into the canter for 2 years. He's delayed. And then in Acts 27:1, finally we read that the authorities have given permission now to send Paul over to Rome. The decision is made. Paul is going to go on board a ship, not with privileged class of other sailors, but rather a bunch of prisoners, 276 prisoners. This is an all-expense trip paid by the Roman government to get Paul from where he is to where he needs to be. But the journey is what captures our attention this morning. Remember, Paul knows a little bit about traveling. He's already logged 3,500 nautical miles during his missionary journeys. Earlier in the book, he suffered 3 shipwrecks. He's been in the open sea overnight at least once. And so he knows a little bit about what's happening and what threats or potential dangers may await. So verses 1 through 8, we're going to kind of skip through a few things here in chapter 27. Verses 1 through 8 describe for us the early stages of the voyage. You can look up on the map there and you see where Paul starts out on the south, on the right side there on the screen. He journeys up the shoreline and then he's going to go under the coast of what is today current day Turkey on his way to Rome. But life gets complicated there in the first stages, and that's what verse 1 through 8 describe for us. What the guys who are driving this ship don't realize, number one, winter is coming and weather can be very unpredictable. Notice what it says in verse 9. Much time had been lost after all that zigzagging there, and sailing had already become dangerous because now it was after the fast. Well, what is the fast? The fast was a day when the Jewish people would actually abstain from food. They would repent before God. They would seek forgiveness and reconciliation. It was the most important day on the Jewish calendar. We call it today, if you check on your calendar, Yom Kippur. Have you seen that on your calendar? Sounds like a Canadian football player, Yom Kippur. Nevertheless, that is a day of fasting. And on this day, Paul says it's already after the fast. On our calendar, that would have been October 4th and 5th this past month. After that, weather becomes unpredictable. How many were expecting a frost this week, and then it's 70 degrees? That's kind of what's happening in the Mediterranean. The weather becomes unpredictable. And it continues in verse 10. So Paul warned them, "Men, I can see that our voyage is going to be disastrous and bring great loss to ship and cargo and to our own lives also." They consulted with Paul, but here's the bottom line. They didn't listen to Paul. Paul was the minority. The majority, the centurion and the pilot and owner of the ship, thought otherwise. It is helpful to be reminded that before you go into a storm, God will typically give you a warning. Do we listen? Well, that's another thing. Well, they didn't listen to Paul, and it's also helpful to be reminded that in the Bible, the majority are usually wrong. God has a special, unique way of thinking that often confounds the wisdom of man. It sounded logical to these guys to go ahead and start out on the trip, so they were looking for safe harbor. And in verses 13 through 15, we read about the second big obstacle that they didn't take advantage of or acknowledge: the risk of hurricanes. So verse 13 tells us that a big storm blew in. Now, there are storms that are going to affect us in life, and it may be very encouraging just to be reminded there can be various reasons for those storms. Sometimes we are going to go through a storm of obedience. Paul did nothing wrong. He was perfectly in the will of God, and he had to go through a storm. That was a storm of obedience. You may face the same. There are also storms of disobedience. You do something that's wrong and you're going to suffer the consequences. Do you remember the story of Jonah? Sometimes our disobedience can disrupt our lives. The storms of disobedience from others can also affect life. Well, everybody on that ship was suffering disobedience with Jonah because of his disobedience. Parents in their disobedience can terribly affect their children, and children in their disobedience can affect the well-being of their parents. But there's also the storms of living in a fallen world. This world is broken, and we will suffer some storms simply because we live in a fallen world. I think of the war in Ukraine. I think of a drunk driver. I think of those who suffered from the hurricane. But here's the bottom line. Storms are not allowed to knock us off course. They are not designed for that purpose. They may delay us, detour us, and distress us, but they're not meant to knock us off course. Satan would love for you to make a permanent decision in a temporary situation. Be careful about those decisions that you make when you are in upheaval. And what happens? Well, verse 13 says, a gentle south wind began to blow. Hasn't it been pleasant to have the south wind blowing these last couple of mornings? South winds are enticing. They draw us in. They're tempting. The south winds of pornography can take a young man into storms that he would have never expected. The soft winds of alcohol and drugs and gambling can take people into hurricanes. Verse 14 says that those soft winds blew, but suddenly they found themselves in a wind of hurricane force called what? You see it? A northeastern. What is a northeastern? A northeastern is simply the convergence of two winds. One is coming from the north and the other is coming from the east, and it creates havoc. And if you've been around for a while, you'll remember in 2012, there was a hurricane storm Sandy that came in and wiped out our eastern seaboard. That was a northeastern. How many remember the blizzard of 78? That was a northeastern. The storm of the century, 1950. Ohio State played Michigan in the middle of the storm of the century. It was a northeaster. The soft winds enticed them in, and then suddenly they found themselves into a century storm. How do people respond to storms? Well, the way they responded to the storms here is very much like we respond to storms in our own life. Verse 15, some of them gave up and they were driven along in the middle of the storm. You know, there are people who, when a storm hits, they just throw their hands up in the air and said, well, whatever. And the storm can wreck their marriage. The storm can wreck their career. They can loosen their values, their morals, their direction in life. They just give up and the storm blows it all away. There's no fight. There's no resistance. There's no comeback in their lives. And other people in verse 18 can go the other side. They can overreact. What's the same verse 18? They began to throw the cargo overboard. Now think about this. What is the cargo? That's what you eat. That's your wheat. That's the grain. That's the food. And they're throwing it overboard because they think, well, we're going to die anyway. Might as well throw away the food. Some people in life can go overboard and overreact. But notice how Paul reacts. Look at what Paul says in verse 21. After they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them. He said, men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Don't you love it when somebody says, you should have listened to me? Well, it is kind of easy to say after the event, but you should have listened. Do you like it when somebody says, you should have listened before you bought that boat or bought that car or made that investment or went out on that date or went to that party? You should have listened. However, notice the words of Paul in the very next verse, verse 22. See what he says. But now. This is Paul's but now moment. It's halftime. Listen, first half has already passed, but now. There's going to be a change. We are not going to let yesterday affect our tomorrow, and some of us need to make a but now statement into our own lives because the storm has wreaked enough havoc. But now, and listen to what he continues to say, I urge you to keep up your courage. In other words, pour courage back into your life, because what does a storm do? It makes you powerless and you lose all hope. Take courage. Pour it back into your heart. Take courage because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed. We can't change the past. We can't change what happened through the divorce, the party, the poor decision, the storm I'm into now. But now, I'm going to stop allowing the past to control my future. I care too much for my family, my marriage, my kids, my career, my salvation. But now, take courage. The ship will be lost, but not one of you will lose their lives. The only thing that's going to be destroyed is the ship. Now, that's important if your hope is in the ship. But you know, there may be some things you need to abort in life if you want to make this journey. And your ship may not be a boat, but it may be a car. It may be a career. It may be an unhealthy relationship. It may be your 401k. But what you abandon in the storm reveals where your hope is at or where it's not at. And it was not going to be the boat that would get Paul to point B. It would be because Jesus was in his life and Jesus would sustain him. The boat would become unimportant at this time. Be encouraged. If God is in it, you're going to get there. You're going to get there even without the boat. Something very amazing happens here when we get to verses 27 through 29. The storm has driven them for 14 days. They've not seen any stars, moon, sun. It's been darkness and relentless battering of the waves on the boat. They begin to get a little anxious. They do a sounding to see how far they are from the shore. They discover they're 120 feet from the shore on the first sounding. Then they drop sounding a second time and discover now it's 90 feet. And fearing, it says in verse 29, notice verse 29, fearing that they're going to be dashed against the rocks, they drop four anchors and they prayed for daylight. As I watch what happens from here out, I begin to see that while these may not be the four anchors that Paul dropped, I think they're in the text. And I want to encourage you this morning with the anchors that God gives us to survive the storm that you may be in. I heard a sailor one time say that was experienced with sailing. He said, "Your anchor is never too big, especially when you're in a storm." So let's talk about some anchors this morning. What were the anchors that Paul threw down? Anybody have any experience with an anchor? These are heavy. I was fearful it was going to throw me off the stage when I dropped it. But notice the anchor that Paul first identifies going into verse 23. Paul says this, "Last night," as he's speaking to these men, "last night an angel of the God whose I am and whom I serve stood beside me." Paul is saying the first anchor that I'm going to drop into this storm is the anchor of God's presence. God in this storm is with me. Can you say with certainty, and are you holding on to that anchor that's going to hold you steady in the middle of a storm? God visited me last night. He is with me in the midst of this storm, and I am holding on to the anchor of his presence. There's a really remarkable story in the book of Exodus where Moses, God's leader to get the people of Israel out of Egypt all the way into the land of promise. They begin their march. They stop at Mount Sinai. God invites Moses to go up on top of the mountain where he's going to give him the Ten Commandments. During that 40 days of absence, the people in camp begin to lose all sense of responsibility. They lower the fences. Their conduct becomes repulsive to God. In his anger, he wipes out 3,000 people. But God comes back to Moses and he says, "I still want you to take these people to the land of promise." There's a very powerful, intimate dialogue between God and Moses in that moment. Moses is understandably questioning whether he can take these people. He knows that God has gifted him with leadership. He knows that he has the traits. He knows that God's purpose is to get these people into the land of Canaan, but he has a big question, and he asks this of God. In Exodus 33, he says, "But God, if your presence doesn't go with us, don't send us." Are you counting on the anchor of God's presence in your life? Are you able to say, "I'm not going to step into my office tomorrow morning unless I have God's presence. I'm not going to step into the classroom. I'm not going to step out onto the field. I'm not going to go to that particular place unless, first of all, I can count on your presence." The first big anchor that's going to help us through the storm is to count on God's presence. Remember some of the things that God has said just to remind us about the power of God's presence in our lives. To Moses' successor, he says this to Joshua, "Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be terrified, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you where? Wherever you go." My hands are holding on to that promise. In the book of Psalms 46, 1 and 2, "God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in the time of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. God's presence will sustain us." Psalm 23, the great psalm, the shepherd's psalm. And in the very middle of it, he makes this classic statement. "Even though I walk through the valley of what? The shadow of death, I will fear no evil." Why? The next phrase, "Because you are with me." There would be no shadows if there wasn't a light to make the shadow. He is with you in the valley of the shadow of death. Hebrews 13, 5, God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." So the first anchor that we drop in when we're in the storm, we count on the anchor of his presence. Hold on to it. A second anchor in the next verse, verse 24. "Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar." Who is this? This is God himself speaking. This is God reminding Paul, "You have a purpose. You must testify about me. This is my purpose for you." And the good question that is helpful to remember regularly, do you have a purpose from God? You do. What is that purpose? Paul would drop that second anchor and be reminded of the fact God had called him to go to Rome and testify. You have a purpose in a similar way. The storm is not the end. It will not knock me off course. I love what Ephesians 5:10 says. It's just a very simple little verse. It says this: find out what pleases the Lord, and then do it. That's your purpose. Find out what pleases the Lord, and then go do it. Steve Green, the great singer from back several decades ago, would sing to our children as we were raising our kids the little song from Philippians 1:6. You remember that? The words, "And being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it through to completion until the day of our Lord Jesus Christ." What God has started, he will carry through to completion. And if God is in it, it's going to get done. Drop your anchor into the purpose of God for your life. How many this morning realize there's something that God has asked you to do and it's not done yet? Raise your hand. You have purpose. Drop your anchor into that purpose. It will come true. Verse 25, we continue with a third anchor, the promises of God. Paul So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. I have the promise of God, Paul is saying to these other sailors. I'm going to get there. You're going to get there. Be encouraged. Be reminded that God's promises always come true. God's principles can always be counted on, and God's prophecies will always come to pass. If God said it's going to happen, it's going to happen. And if it hasn't happened yet, it will happen. But hold on to his purposes and his promises. And finally, notice what it says in verse 2. That's not a mistake. We're going to go backwards. I want you to go back and just observe this tiny little tidbit that's powerful. All the way back in verse 2, before the storm even hits, it says, we boarded a ship from, how do you say that word? Adramidium. I wished it was Adamsville or Akron or something like that, but it's not there. About to sail for ports along the coast of the province of Asia, and we put out to sea. Who is the we who wrote the book? Dr. Luke. Paul has a person next to him by the name of Luke, who was a doctor, probably a personal physician attending Paul on this trip. But not only Luke, Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica, was with us. Who was Aristarchus? Some would think Aristarchus purposely surrendered himself to Roman slavery so he could be a partner with Paul on this trip. In other words, when we're in the storm, we need the people of God. We need people around us. And the presence and the purpose and the promises of God are all important, but we need some other people. You know what Satan wants us to think this morning? He wants you and I to think that we are by ourselves in the storm. I'm the only one that has this weakness. I'm the only one that has this sinful flaw. I'm the only one that's struggling with this addiction, and he wants you to think you're by yourself. But when we connect with people, we realize, boy, they're just like me. And together, we pull each other, sustain each other, we take hands, we pray, and we survive the storm. Watch this video with me of a person that we all know and how that has been important in her own life.
I had a very strong faith growing up, and I thought that I was very anchored in my faith. However, on that Monday morning, my mom and I were at home, and my dad had a heart attack, and we were there, and we were with him when he passed, and that's when everything kind of changed. I still had that faith, but I had lots of other emotions going on around me. I was scared. I was angry at God. I was confused and really just lost. We decided that we needed to find a church to help us get through all of this. And luckily, the Heath Church of Christ very graciously hosted my father's funeral. And they really opened us completely with open arms. We got to know everyone in the church, and you know, we came more often. Then the big changing factor was when we got into a journey group. That fall, we started a journey group at the Lynn's house with a couple different people. And then over the next couple months, we started to get more of a cohesive group together that would come every week and really got to know each other. And we finally, within that next year, had a full group that we all really connected. In that group, I was blessed to have Jim Roberts, who had also lost a parent at a very young age. And it was really wonderful to connect with someone who had gone through that journey as well and was able to talk to those emotions and fears I had Another thing that really helped the situation was we had some of the individuals in that journey group that started going through very hard times also, and we were there together to help each other get through it. We had a couple going through some cancer scares. We had someone who had also lost a son in the group. We had just so many people to support and talk through those different things. And I really don't know if I could have refound my faith without that group. Over these last couple years, I've figured out why God had this part of my plan, why at the age of 21, he had taken away someone who I really saw as my best friend and one of my guiding people in my life. And I see now God has a plan for me, and he brought these people into my life in order to help me through this. Also, I believe my hope journey has helped me to spread that story and also help others who have been in the same situation. I've seen people at my job or some of my friends who have also lost family members. And I believe God put me in this situation to be able to spread his word and help people get through these hard times with the love of God and knowing that he's there with us every step of the way.
We have 25 journey groups that are functioning right now. We would love and we need to start more. And I want to encourage you, if you're not part of a group, if you're not part of a smaller fellowship of people, to get connected. Well, this journey finally ended. How many like to be at a place like what's up on the screen? Doesn't that look nice? But very seldom is there a straight line between point A and point B. But you know what? In the middle, there's an anchor. And when the storm hits, hold on to the presence of God. Hold on to the purposes of God. You have been created for a purpose. Find that purpose and do it. Rest in the promises of God. If God has said it, it's going to happen. And connect deeply with the people of God. And one day, you'll get there. And what he has created for us will be far greater than any storm you'll go through in this life. You know, we finish up this chapter, we finish up the book of Acts, and I guess the big temptation might be to think, well, if I'm just in the boat, I'll get there, right? But the boat didn't get anybody to the destination. The boat was destroyed. And there are also those today that think, well, if I'm just in church, I'll make it. It's not enough just to be in church. It's a wonderful thing that you're in church. But there are really two sets of people. There are those who are in Adam, and then there are those who are in Christ. And through the church, we are introduced to a new birth that transfers us from the lineage of Adam to the lineage of Christ. And Paul says it so well when he says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is past and the new has come. The boat won't get you there, but Jesus will. And there's nothing that he would love to do more this morning but to welcome us into a new birth and a new life and new anchors to survive the storm. If you would like to make a decision this morning, we would love to come alongside, help you. I'd like to invite you to stand up, and our worship team's going to lead us in a time of worship. Where do you go in a storm without anchors? Well, the storm's going to drive you, but with anchors, you're surviving and you're going to reach your destination. Let's worship the Lord. If we can be of assistance, pray. We welcome you to respond.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. This is our story of hope together. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested, my life began. So free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. When death was arrested, my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
We are continuing to pray for all of the counties in Ohio, and we join this prayer movement with all churches in the state throughout these counties as we head into the International Conference on Missions being held here in our state. This morning, we are going to pray for Trumbull County, for Tuscarawas, Union, Van Wert, Vinton County, Warren, and Washington County. Please join me in prayer. God, as we take time this morning to lift up these counties in our state, God, we pray that the people there come to know you. God, we pray that all that is going on within those counties, the crime, the drug use, poverty, whatever the case may be, that God, you work in those situations to redeem those situations. God, we pray for the churches that are in that county. We pray that your Spirit will work through them, that you will use them to find those in the county that need a relationship with you. God, as we leave here this morning, we pray that your love continues to work and show through us. God, we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Thanks for being here this morning. Have a great week.
Oh, sing hallelujah. our open life.